So thank you, Jim, for taking the time for this short interview. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing really well. Love Paris, what can I say?
Cool, awesome. So me and Jim have been in Paris for some time, doing a small workshop for InnoEnergy, that is an European organization that tries to foster innovation in the energy sector. But what I wanted to talk about with Jim is maybe first try and introduce yourself and tell us what you've been up to in the last few years.
Yeah, sure. So my name is Jim Gao. I worked at Google for about 9 years, about 6 years at Google and about 3 years at DeepMind. I originally started off as a data center engineer, actually, a mechanical engineer. Mm-hmm. I was designing and operating large data centers, which consume a lot of energy. During the course of my work, I picked up some machine learning. So and decided that it would be a really good idea to try to apply some machine learning to the data that I was already analyzing as part of my job. During that process, I discovered that machine learning does a really good job at optimizing large mechanical and electrical systems within data centers. We got about a 40% energy savings in our Google data centers.
Which is insane.
Yeah, it was pretty good.
Yeah. I guess we were very happy about it.
So after that, I left Google and went to DeepMind to start a team that is focused primarily around fighting climate change through the application of AI technologies. And this would include bringing these AI technologies to other industrial applications beyond data centers, and also applying AI to renewable energy like wind farms, right, to try to make that more predictable and therefore more valuable. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, it sounds like. So a lot of people ask me, why AI and energy? I have some ideas, but what are your ideas on why AI and energy?
Yeah, it's a good question. Energy is often a very overlooked space, and I would broaden it to just AI and the industrial sector more broadly. So when I talk about industrials, I'm talking about large physical infrastructure. So things like energy, things like water utilities and distribution, for example, manufacturing, right? Semiconductors, metallurgical, work, smelting, etc. Right? I would also include things like transportation and logistics, in there as well. And the reason why the industrial sector is so appealing for AI is because this is a sector that hasn't really changed in the last 20, 30 years, right? So it's ripe for disruption. We often talk about the industrial revolutions. Well, the third industrial revolution happened in the 1980s, 1990s, when with the advent of computerized networks, right, everything started becoming digitized and automated, but in a very dumb fashion, right? So you get all these utilities and you get all these factories, and power plants that have been automated to some extent, right? And therefore they've been collecting all this data in order to automate. Yeah. But the automation is around really simple rules and heuristics that don't capture the complexity and therefore can't fully optimize an industrial system or adapt as the system changes over time. Right. So as a result, this industry overall has been collecting data for 20, 30 years, but nobody's really done anything with the data and highly, highly complex systems, which, that combination of data richness and the combination of, of a highly complex domain application area makes it a really appealing area for AI.
Yeah. And I'm wondering, so I remember when I was studying energy engineering, I remember we were doing all this super complex thermodynamics to try to squeeze 2% more out of something, and then suddenly you bring this new technology and you get 40%. So my question is, why didn't that happen before? Like, what do you think? It's just now. I mean, of course, AI has developed a lot now.
Yeah.
But internet companies have been using it for maybe 10 years now.
Yeah.
What does the energy industry need to use this, efficiently?
Well, it wasn't for lack of trying, I'll tell you that, right? My early job was to optimize these large industrial facilities, right? So I actually spent many years, coding in MATLAB, R, and Python, analyzing these data sets. But we have to understand that these are highly complex systems, right? And the human brain, it's good at many things, including creative tasks, but it's not good at analyzing extremely large volumes of data. Right, your simplest industrial system today can generate thousands of data trends, right? And if you think about it, like you and I, we can analyze, two or three data trends. On a good day, maybe we can analyze 5 or 10 data trends, but there's no way that we can analyze thousands of data trends simultaneously to find the hidden story that's told within the data, right? But that story is there. We need algorithms to unearth, you know, the insights that are locked within that data. So, you know, my answer here is that, you know, the insights and the valuable insights are lying hidden like buried treasure within the data,
yeah.
right? But the human brain is not optimized for analyzing large volumes of data, mm-hmm. whereas computers are, right? Mm-hmm. We just haven't had the right hardware and the right software, right, until now, until recently, yeah. right, to unlock the value of those insights.
So, again, 40% is a lot.
Yeah.
So what do we need to make the whole world cut their energy consumption by 40% using AI? What are the barriers that we yeah. need to overcome?
Yeah, there's a couple of major barriers, none of which are insurmountable. Otherwise, I wouldn't have dedicated a career to this, right?
Of course, yeah.
You know, there is one very obvious barrier, which is AI knowledge and expertise, right? Mm-hmm. So, as you said, AI itself has been a technology that has been around for a while, right? But primarily, if you look at who has gotten the most value out of AI, right? Who has made, you know, billion-dollar applications using AI? It's companies like Amazon and Netflix and Apple, right? They're primarily tech companies, and that's because AI today is an incredibly powerful technology, but not very many people have access to that technology yet, right? It reminds me a lot of software in the early 1990s. If you remember when the internet first came around, right? Website design was incredibly narrow and valuable, right? And you had a couple thousand people in the world who understood how to make websites. They were very highly compensated, and there was, you know, a talent war to get their hands on the best website designers, right? That's AI today. Right, where there are very few people who understand AI, and honestly, most of the AI expertise, right, is locked away in these big companies that can afford the talent, right? So the first thing we need to do is education, right? We need to broaden the general level of expertise so that more people can access the technology. The second thing we need to do is improve the tools, right, that can help people apply AI without needing to be PhDs in it, right? And that's what my new startup does now, right? It's this idea that because AI is such a powerful but it's such an exclusive technology, right, we can create tools that make it more accessible to non-experts, you know, so that if you don't have a PhD in software engineering, you don't have a PhD in mathematics, you can still get all the benefits of applying and commercializing AI.
So this is interesting. I'm trying to put myself in the shoes of somebody who's working today in the energy industry, okay? Because, I mean, there must be thousands of people that are trying to use old tools to squeeze 2% out of a system, right?
Yeah.
So how can these people start leveraging these new technologies? Do you think do you think that every energy engineer should become a data scientist? or maybe there's still need of energy engineers and this must be a cooperation. How do you see this happening?
Yeah, absolutely. It's 100% the latter, right? I've worked at Google and DeepMind for the last 9 years. You know, we've applied AI to dozens of different facilities now. I can tell you from firsthand experience that what works best is combining deep AI expertise with deep domain expertise in the area of application, right? So, you know, if you think about the software engineers who are applying AI on a day-to-day basis, you know, they sit in front of their computers, right? And they see a bunch of numbers, right? That's what the data represents to them, a bunch of numbers. But you or I think you had a mechanical engineering background, right? You or I, when we look at the data, what we see are temperature sensors or voltage data or amperage data, right? That data means something to us, right? So in our experience, AI works best when you combine people with deep AI knowledge with people with deep knowledge of the application domain area. Mm-hmm. So folks like technicians, control room operators, facility managers, right? People with actual hands-on experience, that's, you know, whom you need to combine the AI expertise with. And oftentimes we find, you know, that the ultimate goal, right, is if you can help those people, right, apply AI directly, right? So that your AI engineers can focus on the education and the tools and infrastructure, right, and put AI in the hands of the users directly. You know, in my mind, the best analogy here is a website called Wix.com, right, where you know, going back to the website analogy we discussed earlier, it used to be the domain of experts only who can make websites. But today, like, you don't need to know how to program. I don't know how to program in HTML5 or CSS or JavaScript. But if I go to Wix.com today, I can drag and drop different websites. All that complexity, all that JavaScript, whatever, has been hidden away so that even non-experts like me can use the technology. And that's ultimately what we need to build towards. Yeah. But in the meantime, what absolutely works best is combining the AI experts with the domain experts, right? That's the only way this can work. I've been on teams where it's AI experts and software engineers only, mm-hmm. and that can lead to bad outcomes.
Yeah, I've seen that a couple of times as well. Like, one of the challenges we have seen when combining domain experts and AI experts is that you still need to have some common ground of knowledge.
Yeah,
I don't know what's your experience about it, but we noticed that if the AI expert doesn't know anything at all about the domain, then things are messy. And especially when the domain expert doesn't know anything about AI, then, you know, there are strange expectations. Like, I have a problem. Well, I sprinkle some AI and then suddenly the problem is fixed. So have you had any example of good and bad cooperation between between domain experts and AI experts?
Yeah. There's a funny example that comes to mind about, like, that really vividly illustrates the need for deep domain expertise, right? Mm-hmm. I remember when we applied AI to the data centers, right? One of the first things that the AI came back with in terms of recommendations, right, was, you know, the AI came back and it said, hey, I've got the best idea for how to save energy. We should turn everything off, right?
Oh, well, that works, I guess.
And then we realized that, you know, oh shit, we didn't actually constrain the problem correctly, right? And this is a bit of, you know, it's an extreme example, right? But the point I'm getting to is that there is so much domain expertise required to know what are good actions, for example, right? So we also have, you know, a more relevant example perhaps, right? You know, the AI will come back and it'll say, well, we think, you know, I think that we should turn on, you know, chillers 5, 6, and 8 out of 12 maybe, right? And it's hard to know as a software engineer, is this a good action? Is this a bad action, right? How do you know, right? But if you ask a technician who has spent her entire lifetime, you know, around these, professional lifetime around these systems, she'll instantly tell you if this is a good recommendation or bad. And especially in those very early days of applying AI, right? When, you know, you're largely in prototyping mode or you're troubleshooting, you know, the technology, right? So early innovation. Right, that mixture of expertise is incredibly useful and incredibly powerful.
Okay, that's very valuable. If you had to give one tip to an organization that is trying to play with AI and start doing the first, you know, AI experiments, what would this tip be?
Just one tip.
You can do as many as you want. I think one, it's fun because it's short. But if you want to give 2, 3, 4, 5, 26.
Two major thoughts come to mind. The first thing is that I would advise companies to start today, right? A lot of the companies I've had the fortune of talking with, AI can often seem as a very daunting new technology, or a technology that is relevant only to big technology companies like Google, Microsoft, or Amazon. I can guarantee you that is not true, right? The world we live in today is so digitized and so globalized that there is nowhere that is safe from competition or disruption, right? Software is completely changing the way the world operates. Right? And because software is a digital layer that cuts across every single industry, we are starting to see massive consolidation across every single industry. And companies cannot afford to wait, right, to apply AI. This is, you know, when your products become commodities, right, in a global market, the best and most valuable differentiator is intelligence. Right? So I don't think companies should wait to start, right? And it can be even something like starting small. Make some prototypes, right? Test those prototypes, you know, with real customers, right? Have a rapid feedback cycle, right? To, you know, it doesn't, you don't have to invest tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars in new products, sure. right? You can do rapid iteration. The second thing that I would recommend companies to do is to invest in data hygiene, right?
Okay.
So a lot of, you know, it's well known that AI works on data, right? But, you know, speaking from years of experience, both good and bad, right? More data does not necessarily mean better results, right? As we know, data quality trumps data quantity any day. So the second piece of advice here is to start collecting data if you haven't already started collecting data already. But make sure that the data that you collect is high quality data. That is, you know, you have someone who has vetted the data on a semi-regular basis. You know, someone who ensures that the data is consistently recording, for example, right? That the sensor data hasn't gone bad, that the sensor names are named correctly, yeah. you know, the sensors aren't, you know, drifting and in dire need of calibration, right? There's a lot of work that goes into data cleanliness. And this upfront work, while it may seem painful, will pay 10x, 100x dividends easily. Right. The worst thing that can happen is if you start collecting data, and then once when you actually have an application, a data science or an AI application that could be quite valuable, and you start analyzing and you realize, oh shoot, you know, this data isn't anywhere near as good as I yeah. thought it would be, right? Then you have to start over. So you know, I think one of the easiest upfront things to do is to start collecting the data and make sure there's high quality data. Right. And, you know, there are lots of folks, including, you know, your own domain experts within your own company who can advise on what good data quality means, right, yeah. for that company.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I think it's interesting because some of these things, I think, are very specific to the energy industry.
Yeah.
But data quality and the cooperation between domain yeah. experts, we saw it in
that's
a bunch
everyone.
Of, we yeah. saw it everywhere. And I think it's interesting how giving the power to domain experts
yeah.
to use AI seems to be...
Yeah.
Seems really to be the key.
Super
here.
Key, yeah.
We saw it in, you know, from fashion yeah. to healthcare, yeah. energy. Yeah. It's I mean.
Yeah, and it makes sense, right? Like, this is the only way that the future will play out.
Yeah.
Right. Because the ones who have AI, deep AI knowledge today, the experts, right? They're primarily software engineers or mathematicians, right? They've never been in the fashion industry. They've never been in the energy industry, right? If you showed one of them a chiller, they wouldn't know what they're looking at. They've never played with it, understandably, mm. right? But the technicians, the, you know, the fashion designers, this is their living every single day, right? AI isn't a magic bullet. It is a tool to help you achieve something, right? You don't give tools to somebody who has no knowledge of the domain. You give tools yeah. to somebody who actually knows how to use the tool, right, and how to get the best results out of it. So in this sense, yes, absolutely. You know, in my mind, there's no doubt that the future is empowering the domain experts to apply and commercialize AI in the most valuable way possible. Only they will have that knowledge.
Right? I think that's the most positive message possible to close this interview. I can't think, like, I will go on for hours, but I can't think of any possible yeah. better. And so I'm gonna thank you here for taking this time
Perfect.
And for playing with us at the workshop these days.
Yeah, hey, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And best of luck for all your future
all right.
endeavors.